prayer, inshallah, to assemble. Jazakumullahu khairan. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wassalatu wassalamu ala Rasulihi Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. So these are the chapters related to etiquettes and morals. And the chapter that is before us is related to, or the few chapters that are before us are related to speech and the etiquettes surrounding speech and communication. So the title that is mentioned here by Imam Nawawi in chapter 88, Istihbab Tib al Kalam, the recommendation to have pleasant speech. وطلاقه الوجه عند اللقاء, and when we meet someone to communicate with someone, then it should be with the smile, it should be with the openness of the face, the pleasure and the smile that should be on the face. So two verses are mentioned by Imam Nawawi. Number one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Hijr, وَخْفِضْ جَنَاحَكَ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, lower your side or your wing for the believers. This is an expression that is used in the Arabic language. Literally, janah means a wing. So to lower your wing for the believers, meaning when we meet another believer, there should be utmost respect. The key in any sort of interaction, in any sort of communication, is respect. Even if we have something that may be disliked to the person that we are addressing, but it's a matter of justice, it's a matter of goodness, it's a matter of truth, the approach should also be appropriate, pleasant, and a way that a person would be receptive to listen. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَخْفِضْ جَنَاحَكَ, lower your sides, lower your wing for the believers. And the next verse that is mentioned, this is a verse of Surah Al-Imran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْفَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, had you been harsh-hearted, then the people around you would have abandoned you. لَنْفَضُّوا, the people around you would have abandoned you, forsaken you. So the Prophet ﷺ's merit, his position, his status is being described via these verses, that the Prophet ﷺ was so gentle in terms of his approach and his method of communication, his character, his morals, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the opposite nature. And Allah said, had you been harsh-hearted, ghaleez, coarse, rough, hard, لَنْفَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ, then the people would have abandoned you. And لَنْفَضُّوا is an Arabic terminology which actually means they would flee from you. They would have fled from you, never to see you and communicate with you. And we know that the character of the Prophet ﷺ was such that it would captivate people. And I mentioned to a group of people recently as well that the Prophet ﷺ many times in some of the journeys where it wasn't a journey for da'wah, it wasn't a journey where he went out of his way to invite people. For example, the migration journey. The Prophet ﷺ migrated, and he migrated from routes and from paths that were unknown. It wasn't the main road, because the people in Mecca, they were looking for him. But in that route, by the time he approached and entered Medina, there were already 70 people that had accepted Islam. The Prophet ﷺ, he left with Abu Bakr, but when he entered Medina with 70 people. And every one of these 70 people had encountered the Prophet ﷺ for the very first time. And they communicated with him, they saw his character, they saw his approach, and this captivated them to accept Islam, that when the Prophet ﷺ entered, he's entering with an entourage of 70 individuals. So the ulama, they explain, they write, that this was not a journey of da'wah. The Prophet ﷺ didn't go out to give da'wah in this journey of migration. It was a hidden journey where he was hiding and he was trying to get himself away from the armies that were sent to search for the Prophet ﷺ. So the Prophet ﷺ was so good in terms of his character that this captivated people to come near to the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. So again, the key message is when we communicate with people, it may be a rightful message. It may seem that this is a message that they're hearing for the first time and they don't agree with it. But the Prophet ﷺ, he was upfront and he said the message, but it was said in the most beautiful way. It was, the Prophet ﷺ used wisdom, he used hikmah, he used basira, insight, before he addressed the matter. So he not only captivated their minds intellectually, but also their hearts through his character, through his morals. So there are a few narrations here. The first narration is on the strength of Adi ibn Hatim radiallahu an. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, اتقوا النار, fear the hellfire. ولو بشق تمرة, even though it may be with a piece of a date. شق تمرة, even though it may be through the piece of a date. فمن لم يجد, if a person doesn't even have that, then فبكلمة طيبة, then keep yourselves away from the hellfire even through a pleasant word, even through a good word, a good statement. So there are many things that are mentioned under the explanation of this hadith. One of them is that the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, is giving us a warning here that the hellfire is not something that is minute. It's not something that is small. It's not something that a person should not be fearful of. It's devastating. It's a reality. It's real. It will come. It's horrible. So the Prophet ﷺ says, اتقوا النار, fear the hellfire. To the extent that the Prophet ﷺ is saying that even through the piece of a date. Now the ulama explained the Prophet ﷺ was talking about charity. When he mentioned this, he was talking on the topic of charity. So the Prophet ﷺ said, look, when you give charity, it will take you further away from the hellfire. Right? And that's why there's another narration we've heard many times, that الصَّدْقَةُ تُطْفِئُ غَضَبَ الرَّبْ, that the charity, it reduces the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's such a great deed, charity, to give, to share from our blessings and our bounties that Allah has blessed us with the less fortunate, or where the need may be. It's so powerful that it reduces the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we see many customs amongst many Muslim cultures where they say, look, I'm in this difficulty, I'm going to give some sadaqah, and hopefully Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will look at me with mercy through this charity and remove or reduce the difficulty. So that comes from the very same hadith where the Prophet ﷺ is talking about charity reduces the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So point number one is that the hellfire is not something that is imaginary. It's a reality, it's real, it will happen, it's going to come. And we will all cross the sirat. وَإِن مِّنكُمْ إِلَّا وَارِدُهَا. We're all going to cross the sirat over the hellfire. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the Prophet ﷺ says here, that we should fear the hellfire. Number two is that even though it may be through a small piece of a date, meaning that if the call is being made to give charity, never ever feel that, oh, this small charity will not be of benefit. Even if it's a piece of a date, half a date, someone needs food, and you give them half a piece of a date, that also can bring someone very close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That charitable cause can bring someone closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It can reduce the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now another thing that is mentioned here is that we should never underestimate any good deed. We should never underestimate any good deed, even a piece of a date, even a small action could take a person very far. And that's why the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, mentions in another narration that even through a shoelace, a person can, even through a shoelace, seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's help. A person needs a shoelace, something that generally is looked upon as insignificant or less important. But the Prophet ﷺ says, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is vast, His mercy is vast. And the key is asking. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, build your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even though it may be for something minute. Likewise, a small deed, a small sin, it can either take a person very far or distant, or very close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet ﷺ says, فَمَنْ لَمْ يَجِدْ, that if you don't have charity to give, even that small piece of date, like one brother said, whenever anyone calls for charity, I make sure I give even a dollar, or less than a dollar. Right, so at least I could be part of the charity, or at least I could be part of that call. If I can't give much, I'll give a little, whenever a call is made. So the Prophet ﷺ says, if you don't have anything to give in a physical, tangible form, فَبِكَلِمَةٍ طَيِّبَةٍ, then say a good word. So there's a beggar who's asking, you know, I don't have some, you know, I don't have my needs, I need something, and you're not in a position to give, or you don't have anything to give. So instead of saying something wrong like get a job, right, say some good words. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala relieve you of your efforts. Give a dua, give a supplication, right? So the Prophet says, if you don't have anything charitable to give in a tangible form, فَبِكَلِمَةٍ طَيِّبَةٍ, say something good, say something that is encouraging, that will make his day, that will empower someone. Okay, if someone's feeling down, we say a statement or two encouraging that person, it can make his day, it can make that person feel in a high spirit. So this is exactly what the Prophet ﷺ is talking about here, that we should be pleasant in our words. Imam Nawawi says, istihbabu tibil kalam. This is a chapter that shows the recommendation, the istihbab, it's mustahab, it's recommended through the teachings of Islam, that we choose our words that are pleasant when we communicate. The next narration, the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, says in this famous narration, on the strength of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, al-kalimatu tayyibu sadaqa, that a good word, a pleasant word, is also a form of charity. A good word is also a form of charity. So as the commentators explain, bayanu shumuli sadaqati li anwa'il khair, charity is not restricted to money. Charity can be done in many forms. And in one narration, the Prophet ﷺ speaks about so many things. He said saying subhanallah can also be a charity, right? Smiling at someone can also be a charity. Removing an obstacle from the path is also a charity. So these are all different forms of sadaqah. It's all different forms of charity. This shows here shumul, that there's many ways that we can do good. It's not restricted to one specific way. Some people, they're very good at a particular good deed. You know, someone can sit down and recite so many juz of the Quran, right? Others, they don't have the time to do that. But every one of us has some form of ability to do some form of good. So we should never underestimate the power of any good. Whatever it may be, anything that is good, be encouraged and empowered to do that. It's a form of charity. And again, the Prophet ﷺ in this chapter of pleasant speech, the Prophet ﷺ says pleasant speech is also sadaqah. Right? And if it's sadaqah, if it's charity, then it'll reduce the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa Abi Dharr radiyallahu an, the next narration on the strength of Abu Dharr, anhu qal, where the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, la tahqiranna min al ma'ruf, never underestimate anything of the ma'ruf, anything of that is good. Ma'ruf refers to anything mustahsan, anything that would be considered logically and also in terms of religion as good, as husn, as beauty, as good. So never underestimate anything that is good. وَلَوْ أَن تَلْقَى أَخَاكَ بِوَجْهٍ طَلِيقٍ, even though it may be to meet your brother with a smiling face. Meaning that we are pleasant when we interact with others. So interaction with another human being, part of the etiquette is our words are full of respect, they're pleasant, and at the same time, we also show pleasantness in our attitude. Right? Sometimes we're with people, they're in a very bad mood. They seem very angry. They seem, you know, so a person doesn't want to communicate, you know. I might, instead of getting some benefit, I might get some loss. I might get into an argument. So stay away. So this wasn't the nature of the Prophet. He was very pleasant. People wanted to talk to him. He was open to all kinds of questions. He was open to all kinds of issues. Right? And the Prophet, he dealt with every issue in a matter that was very pleasant. A young man came to him and said, I want to commit adultery. The Prophet ﷺ didn't get angry, he didn't shout at him. The Prophet ﷺ sat him down, explained to him in a very pleasant way that he understood the message. At the same time, he said, look, this is a man with high morals and character. Right? A Bedouin comes and urinates in the mosque. And the Prophet ﷺ speaks to him, and this man says, I've never seen a man or a teacher who has so much character. I did such a drastic mistake, but never was I reprimanded, never was I beaten, never was I told anything that was very negative. The Prophet ﷺ got the message across, and I learned my lesson, and from that point onwards I learned the etiquettes of the masjid. So again, this shows the character and the pleasantness in the interaction. So we interact with so many human beings. Insan means uns, comes from uns, which means our attachment with others. So as human beings, we're bound to interact with each other, but our interaction should be pleasant. Even in the most negative situations, you know, many times There are differences of opinions in certain matters. Okay? So many times people don't agree, even many scholars. We see, for example, Imam Abu Hanifa in disagreement with Imam Shafi on major issues. Right? But when we look at what each of them said about each other, it's mind-boggling. So much respect. So much respect. Even in matters of difference of opinion. Many times it was the same school or methodology of fiqh. For example, Imam Abu Hanifa, he had two major students, Imam Abu Yusuf and Imam Muhammad al-Shaybani. Both of them had difference of opinion with their teacher, Imam Abu Hanifa. But Imam Abu Hanifa never ever looked down upon their disagreements. He said, let us record this in our works, that we've come up with a decision, that this is what it is. However, Imam Abu Yusuf differs in this opinion, and Imam Muhammad differs in this opinion, but they were still student and teacher. They were still full of respect. Right? So, the point is that our interaction with other human beings, even in matters where we disagree, right, it should be to the intellectual debate. It should be with the issue. It shouldn't be with the human being, with the other person. Right? Now, on the same note, the next chapter, Imam Nawawi says, Istihbabu bayani al-kalam. We're talking about speech, so he's saying that it's important that when we speak, people should understand our speech. And if we feel that there is a danger that people will not understand our speech, then we need to clarify our speech or repeat our statements. So what does he say? Bayanu al-kalami wa idahihi. The importance of explaining one's speech and expounding on it, especially for the person who there is a danger, lam yafham. The person will not understand. Wa takriru, and to repeat it. Sometimes a person says something once, but we can't really hear it. We can't really understand it. So if a person feels that a person is not getting the message, then I need to repeat myself. I need to make myself clear. And there's many reasons for this. If a person doesn't understand the communication, they won't act appropriately in accordance to that message. Or they'll take the wrong message and pass it on to someone else. And that's why we see here in this narration, the first narration on the strength of Anas, radiallahu anhu, he mentions that the Prophet ﷺ, إِذَا تَكَلَّمْ, whenever he spoke, أَعَادَهَا ثَلَاثًا, he repeated it three times. Whenever the Prophet ﷺ spoke, he repeated it three times. حَتَّى تُفْهَمَ عَنْهُ, so that people would understand him. Anas radiallahu anhu says, why did the Prophet ﷺ repeat his statements three times? So that people could understand his message. وَإِذَا أَتَى عَلَىٰ قَوْمٍ, and whenever he came to a group of people, فَسَلَّمَ عَلَيْهِمْ, he would make salam upon them. He would begin his speech with salam, with greetings of peace. سَلَّمَ عَلَيْهِمْ ثَلَاثًا, and in many cases he would make salam three times. He would repeat the salam three times. Now there is a huge discussion amongst the scholars that what was the reason for the Prophet ﷺ repeating himself. Imam Nawawi believes that the reason is that he needs to make himself clear. Why? When a person is a leader, when a person is in a position of authority, then his statements will be taken seriously, especially if it's the Messenger of Allah. People memorized what he said, and many wrote down what he said. So if they didn't really get the message clearly, they're going to write down something that is inappropriate, and it will be passed on to others. So the Prophet ﷺ made himself very clear. This is what I'm saying, and I'm repeating. And I'm repeating again. Now many ulama say another reason was that at that time there were no microphones, as we see here. Right? So there would be huge gatherings. In the initial stage of the Prophet's life in Medina, there were approximately majority about 2,000 to 3,000 companions. And after the victory of Mecca, it went into the thousands, 10,000. So the Prophet ﷺ, he started getting a large group of people, and many times he would address them, as we will see in one of the coming narrations. At the occasion of Hajjatul Wida, there were 124,000 companions, and he's trying to get a message across. So the Prophet ﷺ did two things. One is that he repeated his statement three times, so he would face in this direction, the right direction, and make the statement, then towards this side and then this side. And he had appointed people to repeat what he was saying in large gatherings. Mukabbir. We generally see this when there's a large gathering and there's salah. and the takbir is repeated. So likewise, many times, an example is at the occasion of Hajjatul Wida, the Prophet ﷺ appointed a few companions that you repeat what I'm saying so that the people towards the back can hear me. So the Prophet ﷺ wanted his message to be heard, and he also wanted that message to be understood. Many contemporary scholars say this shows that the Prophet ﷺ wanted his message to be known to people, right? And this is part of da'wah. When we want to get a message across, we need to look at how can our message get to the maximum amount of people. So nowadays we have a lot of technology, right? And again, we've heard this many times, that these are all tools, you know, the internet, media broadcasting, social websites. If we use this to propagate good, to spread good messages, then this will give us rewards on the Day of Judgment. But if we use this inappropriately, all this technology, then it's going to go against us. It's going to go against us. So the Prophet ﷺ wanted his message to be heard. So this is why he adopted repeating several times. And at the same time, he also appointed people to carry on his message, to repeat his message. And he also repeated himself. So Anas radiallahu anhu says, إِذَا تَكَلَّمْ, whenever the Prophet ﷺ spoke, بِكَلِمَةٍ, it could many times be only a word. But what did he do? أَعَادَهَا ثَلَاثًا. He repeated it three times so that he could be understood. وَإِذَا أَتَى عَلَىٰ قَوْمٍ, whenever he came upon any people, the first thing he did is he broke the ice. You see, someone asked, a non-Muslim asked, that what's the difference between saying hi, hello, and saying assalamu alaikum? So I said that assalamu alaikum is a dua, it's a prayer, it's a supplication. Hi, hello is just simply breaking the ice. It doesn't really have a meaning to it. It's just to break the ice. You say hi and someone responds hi. Right? But when it comes to Islam, when a Muslim meets another, we say assalamu alaikum. We say may peace be with you. Meaning, I'm meeting you and there's no harm here. I'm interacting with you and there's nothing to be fearful of. I'm full of peace in my speech, in my character, in my morals, and in the way I interact with you. And the response should always be, wa alaykum as-salam. In fact, the Quran says, wa idha huyitum, whenever you are greeted, fahayyu bi ahsana minha, then give a better greeting in response. So the Prophet ﷺ, many times he would say, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, or assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And these were additional du'as. May Allah's mercy be with you. May Allah's blessings be with you. Right? So the response should be even better. And the whole idea is we break the ice and we also make a prayer for each other and then start our interaction and our communication. So this brings so much rewards. You know, in one narration, a man came and he said, assalamu alaikum. The Prophet ﷺ said, ashara, 10 rewards for this brother. Another person came and said, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Prophet ﷺ said, ashreen, 20. This person gets 20 rewards. Another person came, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. The Prophet ﷺ said, thalathoon. This person's got 30 rewards. Right? So our words will be rewarding when they're blessed, when they're pleasant, when they're appropriate. So again, what we understand from here, that even when the Prophet ﷺ made salam, he said it audibly. Sometimes people make salam and they don't raise their voice. They say, what kind of imam is this? He doesn't even respond to my salam. Sorry, brother, I didn't hear your salam. Right? Say it audibly. Right? So, you know, and you get the opposite as well. You know, I was in the shopping center once and saw a brother. He said, assalamu alaikum. So he said, how did you know I was a Muslim? So you shouldn't be embarrassed. You shouldn't be embarrassed, you know. He said, brother, everyone has nur. Every Muslim has nur on their face, and I saw your nur. I saw your light, so I made salam to you, brother. So we should greet each other. These are prayers. These are du'as. In the next narration here, the Prophet ﷺ is being quoted by Aisha, by the wife of the Prophet ﷺ. كَانَ كَلَامُ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمْ كَلَامًا فَصْلًا. Whenever the Prophet ﷺ spoke, he was very clear. He didn't mumble jumble words. He wasn't unsure of his words or his statements. He was very clear and he was very confident in what he said because it was the truth. Right? They say the best salesperson is the one who is confident on the product. Right? Who knows the product, who's confident, who's possibly using it himself. Okay, a person is selling a Toyota but is driving a Mercedes. So if Toyota is so good, why are you driving a Mercedes? Right? You need to be confident on your statements.
You need to be confident on what you're saying. So the Prophet ﷺ, he always was confident in his statements and in what he said, to the extent that the Sahaba say many times the Prophet ﷺ, whenever he would deliver a sermon, we would feel as if an army is coming. When he would warn about the hellfire, we were under this perception that an army is coming and will be destroyed. That's how real he made the issue, that we felt its presence. And when the Prophet ﷺ talked about paradise, we felt that, you know, the paradise is right before us. We want to just leave this world and enter paradise. So how could this happen when he was confident and when he had the ability to get that message very clearly to them? Faslan. Faslan means very open and very clear. كَانَ كَلَامُ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فَصْلًا يَفْهَمُهُ كُلُّ مَنْ يَسْمَعَ. Everyone who was present would be able to understand. Meaning the Prophet ﷺ didn't use academic jargon that would confuse a person further. A person sits in a lecture for 1 hour and then says, what did the scholar just say? Didn't really understand. So it's academic jargon to the extent where a person can't even get the gist of what is being said. So that's why the idea is not really the powerful words or the academic jargon. It's, can we get the crux of the message, the gist of the message, what is being said? And that's why when you study the hadith, many of the words that the Prophet ﷺ used, they were common words that people spoke, right? So in fact, there is a narration, the Prophet ﷺ says that many of those who speak, they will be amongst those who enter hellfire first. And the explanation of this is that the person who's speaking is really trying to impress people through his words and his the style of speaking, rather than try to give a message that is practical, that is relevant, that brings about positive change. Right? In fact, another narration in Adabul Mufrad of Imam Bukhari, the Prophet ﷺ says that one of the signs of the Day of Judgment is people will speak more, but there will be less amal, less practice. And right now, the Prophet ﷺ said, as it's time, right now we're speaking less, but there's more practice. There's more amal. So we have all these huge conferences. We have so many of these events, event after event, event after event. You know, no place on the notice board to put a poster, because there's so many events on the very same weekend. Okay, a person is confused. Where do I go? There or here? So many events, so many lectures, right? But where's the amal? Where's the practice? So the Prophet ﷺ says in this narration that is quoted in Adabul Mufrad of Imam Bukhari, that there will be a time where speech will increase, amal will decrease. And right now the Prophet ﷺ said during his time, there's more amal, there's more practice and less speech. The Prophet ﷺ spoke few words. His khutbah would be shorter than his salah. The Prophet ﷺ's khutbah on Friday would be shorter than his salah. It's vice versa. Today, brother, they say, you know, you should have spoken more for the khutbah and shortened your prayer. That was too long, brother. I got to get back to work. Right? So we've changed. We want to hear more, and we don't want to practice more. So what the Prophet ﷺ was is very practical. He gave a message, everyone understood it, it was clear, and it was brief, and it was to the point. One more narration here under the chapter of Isgha'ul Jalis, that if there's something good that is being said, we need to take people to that majlis. We need to take people to that gathering. And the Prophet ﷺ, Imam Nawawi is actually indicating through the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that as long as that gathering is not of vice, الَّذِي لَيْسَ بِحَرَامٍ, there should be no vice, no prohibition in that gathering. If it's full of goodness, then we shouldn't go ourselves, we should take another. And here he's also mentioning وَإِسْتِنْصَاتُ الْعَالِمِ وَالْوَعِذِ, the person who's giving the lecture, the person who's giving the khutbah, it's recommended for him to first get the people to calm down and be prepared to listen. Right? He should first get them prepared to listen, thereafter he should give his message. So two points that Imam Nawawi is mentioning. One is that we should not be independent in doing our good. We should always encourage others to join us in doing good. One of my teachers would always say this. Whenever you do good, don't do it alone. Get others to also join you in doing the good. So you're going to an event that's good, right? Ask your friends, ask your family members, let's go. Right? So that one thing is that it'll support you. You'll be confident that you have support. You know someone that you're going with. And another thing is that you're spreading the khayr, you're spreading the good, you're sharing the blessings. And the other point here is that the one who's delivering the message, they should begin with calming the people down before delivering the message. Because the purpose of the message is that it be heard. Now, if everyone is talking, if everyone is busy with what they're doing, it's not going to be heard, right? So many times at weddings, at functions, you know, people say, Sheikh, give a talk. So I say, if you can calm them down first, then I'm ready to speak. What's the point of speaking just for the sake of speaking, right? The purpose is not to deliver the message that such and such an imam came and spoke at the wedding. That's not the purpose. The purpose is, are these people ready to listen? Are they ready to take it in? This is not the forum. It might be not be the forum to deliver the message. So here, the one narration is about the one I gave reference to earlier about Hajjatul Wida. Jarir ibn Abdullah. Jarir ibn Abdullah. He reports that the Messenger ﷺ in Hajjatul Wida told me, meaning he appointed me, وَاسْتَنْصِتِ النَّاسِ, go to the people and calm them down. Istinsat comes from the word where it means, it's derived from the root word which means silence. Insat, to be silent. So the Prophet ﷺ, he saw a big commotion. In the lengthy narrations of Hajjatul Wida, it's mentioned that because of the large crowds, people were looking for the Prophet ﷺ. That where is he? Is he in this direction? Is he in that direction? Because there was no stage, there was no pulpit. So the Prophet ﷺ was on his camel and he started delivering his message. So the Prophet ﷺ noticed that there's a lot of commotion. So he said, I'm not delivering my message. I'm appointing you, I'm appointing you, I'm appointing you. You go in that direction, calm the people down, tell them I'm starting my message. You go in this direction, you go in this direction. So one of these companions was Jarir ibn Abdullah. He says that the Prophet ﷺ told me, go and calm the people down, make them silent, and then I'll deliver my message. So after they were silent, Jarir ibn Abdullah says, one of the statements I remember the Prophet ﷺ told me to repeat. So he was also the mukabbir. La tarji'u ba'di kuffaran yadribu ba'dukum riqaba ba'd. He says, I clearly remember that I was told to repeat these words, that after me, the Prophet ﷺ is saying, after my demise, do not return as disbelievers. Meaning that I've fulfilled my message to propagate it to you, you've accepted the message, and you've taken on the message. Now it's my time to leave. My mission has come to an end. So after I leave, don't return back to kufr. Right? Don't return back to disbelief. Right? So majority of the companions, they were converts or reverts as they say. Right? Majority of the sahaba, they were reverts. They came in from other adyan, from other religions. Many of them were idolaters, many of them were atheists, etc., Christians, Jews. They accepted Islam after seeing Islam. So the Prophet ﷺ warned them and said that after I pass away, don't be amongst those people who return back to kufr. And then he said, because this will cause يَضْرِبُ بَعْضُكُمْ رِقَابَ بَعْضُ. This will cause wars. It will cause you to fight with each other. And then you will lose lives, you will lose respect, you will lose the essence of the message that I'm leaving behind. Right? So this is part of the very lengthy narration that we see in the likes of Imam Bukhari's works, etc., where the whole incident of Hajjatul Wida is mentioned. But this portion has been selected by Imam Nawawi to the fact that when we communicate, the person must be ready to listen. Right? If the person is not prepared to listen, then there's no point in delivering a message where someone's not ready to take it in. Right? So we make dua that Allah bless us with the ability to communicate with character, with pleasant words, with respect and decency. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with the best of etiquettes and morals. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us success in this life and the hereafter. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulihi Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. اللهم ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار اللهم وفقنا لما تحب وترضى من القول والعمل والنية والهدي والهدى إنك على كل شيء قدير سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين جزاكم الله خير